Once again, Christian greetings to all our valued listeners and viewers throughout the whole world, more particularly to all Shepherd's Rod believers, and most especially to our beloved brothers and sisters in the United States of America. Special greetings to our brethren in Colorado and Fiji Island, in Mexico, Spain, and Africa, to the United Kingdom, and also to our brethren in Australia, and to the rest of the 144,000 living saints scattered abroad. Greetings, and may the good Lord bless you, brothers and sisters. This is our episode number 6, the subject, the Day of Slaughter. I would like to begin our study reading 2TG 37, page 11. It says, History and Prophecy, Commandments and Statutes, the Bible. What a gloomy life this would be if there were no history, if there were no possible way of knowing the past, and still worse would it be if there were no prophecy, if there were no way of getting an idea what the future holds. But worse of all would it be if there were no light on the present. Then it says, let me illustrate. Suppose you should look out of your windows, both toward the east and toward the west, and you should see the land lighted for miles around, even to the horizon, but there were no light at all in your own home. Again, suppose you would wish to drive somewhere, and you had a flood of lights both on the rear and on the front of your car, but the motor would not turn over. What good would the car be to you, and what good the lights? That is the exact predicament you would be in if you understood history and understood prophecy, but knew nothing about your own spiritual condition, knew not that you were being overcome by the fiery darts of the devil. It would be like walking over a bridge which, unbeknown to you, was collapsing. You will agree, I know, that it is absolutely necessary to know both history and prophecy. Absolutely necessary to know the past and the future. But this in itself will not profit you if your soul is languishing in darkness, if you are spiritually dead and do not know it. No, this will not profit you anymore than would a car with a flood of light before and behind, but with the motor dead. The life to your soul and the light closest your feet are, therefore, of first importance. 2TG 37, pages 11 and page 12. So here the voice of inspiration are emphasizing that the entire Bible were divided into three lights: history, prophecy, and commandments. And the voice of inspiration is plainly emphasizing that of all these three, the most important is to know the light of your present condition, to know the light concerning our present spiritual condition. And I would like to read this reading in Answerer number 1, page 10, saying, remember, there is a divine law that converts every honest effort into joy, a personal experience with God, and eternal life. So will you not start now to measure yourself no longer by what you think you are or will be, but by what the Lord says you are and must be? So let us follow implicitly this divine admonition that it is high time now to measure ourselves no longer by what we think we are or will be, but by what the Lord says we are and must be. Here I would like to, let me see if I could find a statement given by the Shepherd's Rod. In Pur Symbolico, number 10 to 12, page 2, I would like to read the first paragraph. It is entitled, The Church in Prophecy. As the church of today is conversant with past church history, for symbolic code 10 to 12, page 2. So let us read the statement. It says, as the church of today is conversant with past church history, but totally ignorant of the divine prediction concerning herself, we in an endeavor to enlighten her shall set forth in this article the reason for her ignorance of the prophecies. But let us first refresh our minds by a brief review of the past before turning our attention to the future. In the following few paragraphs, we shall see how completely the Lord has foretold to His church the course that she should, also the course that she would follow, and the ultimate results in either case. Or in other words, since God is a God of freedom, God of liberty, He never forced the will of any of His creature. And what the Lord did is completely telling His people the result, or if she would follow the course that she would, and vice versa, the outcome, if the church would follow the course that God indicated here that she should follow. And the most important part in our study is that to know the present, brothers and sisters, while knowing the past and the future. Or in other words, we need to know the very year in which we are living in. For example, the statement in Two Symbolic Code, number 10, page 4, saying, consequently, the church from 1844 to the close of Prohibition is divided into two sections, the church before the loud cry and the church in the time of the loud cry, the latter of which will, by comparison, be far superior to the former in spirituality. In fact, there is no comparison between the two. Hence, those who cannot tell in which one of these stages the church now is must be in great darkness. The Shepherd's Rod plainly declared in 2 Azar 237, saying, Some may question the evidence for allowing 3 hours to its incident from creation to the fall of Adam, and again to Enoch and Noah. If God worked on the 3-hour schedule with the crucifixion of Jesus, see the chart on page 22, and the same rule was followed in the period called day, then He certainly would not follow another rule in the period called night. The reason He has followed that particular rule is to present to His church the exact time of her history by periods. That is the ultimate divine purpose why our Almighty God followed that particular rule, is to present to His church the exact time of her history by periods. This statement in 2 Azar 237, without any doubts, there must be a specific church by which to that specific church Jesus Christ will present to them the exact time of her history by periods. And undoubtedly, Jesus Christ, having that ultimate power at the time when Jesus Christ will present to them such subject, in order for them to know the exact time of her history by periods to the people by which they were the particular object in view, for sure they will understood it. The very statement in 1 Ezra Pocket Edition on page 58, saying, but now at the appointed time, He Himself reveals their significance to the very people for whom they were originally and especially designed. So at the time appointed, when the appointed time came, Jesus Christ Himself reveals to them all the significance recorded in the Word of God. Jesus Christ would reveal to them so that they might know, so that they will know the exact time of her history by periods. And there is no doubt the church mentioned is the stone recorded in the book of Zechariah. Here in 1 TG, number 14, on page 21. 1TG number 14, page 21. It says, they are the eyes of the Lord. What a momentous day. What a great people. Evidently, they constitute the stone of Zechariah 3, which we studied several weeks ago and learned that it has seven eyes, complete spiritual vision. Obviously, this is the stone that smites the great image, Daniel 2, verse 45. So the voice of inspiration plainly declared that according to the description given in the Bible, in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 10, and also Zechariah chapter 3, verse 8, that this stone has seven eyes. And the meaning is that they had complete spiritual vision, knowing the past, the present, and the future. In 2SR, page 195, it says, before and behind denotes prophetic light, revealing to them the past, present, and future. 2SR 195, before and behind denotes prophetic light, revealing to them the past, present, and future. In the Great Controversy, page 423, it says, light from the sanctuary illumine the past, the present, and the future. The synonym of the word illumine or illumine, meaning lighten. So the subject, the light from the sanctuary, lighten, enlighten, illumine the past, the present, and the future. And several times we did emphasize, according to 2SR 187, saying, in order to make a proper application of the seven seals, we must have a better understanding of the heavenly sanctuary service, its origin, and the object of its existence, as taught by the early sanctuary built by Moses. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5. In the sanctuary construction and service is revealed the plan of salvation. And that is why in the Great Controversy, page 423, it says, it opens to view a complete system of truth, connected and harmonious, showing that God's hand had directed the great Advent movement and revealing present duty as it brought to light the position and work of His people. So only on the subject of the sanctuary, by which we could be able to ascertain clearly what is our present duty at this present time. Without the light of the sanctuary, there is no possibility that we could be able to know our present condition. And that is the reason why the two servants of God is emphasizing the thing that is going on in the heavenly sanctuary. Here in 1SM 122, it says, are we awake to the work that is going on in the heavenly sanctuary? Are we awake, brethren? Or are we among those people who are willingly ignorant, plainly indicating that they deliberately chosen to remain in darkness? I would like to read the statement in Bible Commentary 6BZ 1056. It says, no excuse for willful ignorance. I would that through ignorance ye did it, said Peter. But this ignorance did not excuse the action, for they had great light granted unto them. The statement is made that had they known that he was the Prince of Life, they would not have crucified him. But why did they not know? Why? Because they chose not to know. They had no interest to search. They had no interest to study. And their ignorance proved their eternal ruin. They had the strongest evidence on which to base their faith, and they were under obligation to God to accept the evidence He had given them. Their unbelief made them guilty of the blood of the only begotten Son of the infinite God. In the Great Controversy 430 and 431, it says the condition of the unbelieving Jews illustrates the condition of the careless and unbelieving among professed Christians who are willingly ignorant of the work of our merciful high priest. In the typical service, when the high priest entered the most holy place, all Israel were required to gather about the sanctuary and in the most solemn manner humble their souls before God, that they might receive the pardon of their sins, not be cut off from the congregation. How much more essential in this antitypical Day of Atonement that we understand the work of our high priest and know what duties are required of us. The Great Controversy, page 430 and 431. Volume 6, page 404. Brethren, to whom the truths of God's word had been opened, what part will you act in the closing scenes of this world's history? Are you awake to these solemn realities? Do you realize the groundwork of preparation that is going on in heaven and on earth? And to repeat again, the voice of inspiration says, if the church, 1 TG 51, page 5 and 6, if the church is not commensurably growing and expanding, then how can she be a living church? And how can she keep up with the signs of the times and with the progress in the sanctuary above? That statement can be easily understood, brothers and sisters. Thus, the focal point of the plan of redemption is pointing to Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary. Brethren, the statement in 2 TG 37, page 11 and 12. For example, we, the Shepherd's Rod believers, all of us are expert in explaining Zechariah 6, Zechariah 4, all the fundamental subjects that had been given during the DLI, which they called the Biddick Levitical Institute. We can present those subjects very well, knowing the past, knowing the future, but we are in total darkness. What is going on in the heavenly sanctuary at this present time? Then that is what the Shepherd's Rod is plainly telling us. And that movement was illustrated by the Shepherd's Rod in 2 TG 37, page 11 and 12. That it has complete light. The light at the rear end is very good. The headlight is very good. But the motor of the car is dead. It cannot run. That is the illustration of those people by which they were in total darkness what is going on in the heavenly sanctuary. That is the determined effort of the devil. In the Great Controversy, 518, the great controversy between Christ and Satan that has been carried forward for nearly 6,000 years is soon to close. And the wicked one redoubles his efforts to defeat the work of Christ in man's behalf and to fasten souls in his snares, to hold the people in darkness and impenitence till the Savior's mediation is ended. But if we study closely the sanctuary doctrine, it is even more important to know Christ's mediatorial work in the holy place, the place by which such proceedings is pointing to the blotting out of names. And the devil determined to hold the people in darkness and impenitence till the Savior's mediation is ended. And there is no longer a sacrifice for sin is the object which he seeks to accomplish. Brethren, I would not be weary to read this statement over and over again, that of all the darkness, there is no more damaging than the darkness that Satan could keep his people, or Satan could keep God's people in total ignorance of the things that is going on in the heavenly sanctuary. Here in White House Recruiter, page 31, it says, let us not, however, forget that there is an enemy who is determined to keep God's people in darkness, in ignorance of timely truth. And what more damaging darkness could he seek to keep them in than in ignorance of that which God would have them to know? While their judgment is pending, while they are being weighed in the balances of the sanctuary, none, absolutely none. But at this time, the trumpet is sounding. The cases that are now considered in the heavenly sanctuary at this present time are the cases of those either to be among the living saints or either to be among the living wicked. The judgment for the living in the heavenly sanctuary at this time is now in progress. Here in 2 Ezra 219, it says, while the judgment for the living is in progress, every sin must be confessed and put away. Therefore, it is still provisionary time. Because the voice of inspiration plainly telling us that at the time when the judgment for the living is in progress, that is the time to confess our sins and put away. Then it says, he who would neglect this great privilege will find himself involved in everlasting ruin, cut off from among his people. Ignoring this most vital subject would not profit us in the least. That statement, great privilege. Brothers and sisters, I think the same with the statement in Bible commentary. Here in Bible commentary, 4 BC 11:39, it says, they are privileged to see by faith the work that is going forward in the heavenly sanctuary. I would like to repeat again the statement. 4 BC 11:39. They are privileged to see by faith the work that is going forward in the heavenly sanctuary. What a great privilege given by God to any individual to inform them that the judgment for the living is in progress. But according to the voice of inspiration in 2 Ezra 219, if you would neglect this great privilege, you will not be profited, brothers and sisters. And you only deliberately chosen your own destination, everlasting ruin, according to 2 Ezra 219. The voice of inspiration made it so plain in 2 TG 12, right? On page 29, it says, John truly penned it as a prophecy, but when it actually takes place, then God's agency on earth, the spirit of prophecy in the church, is to proclaim that the event has actually taken place. The judgment for the living is in progress. And soon, very soon, brothers and sisters, on that final day of atonement, we will either leap for joy or gnash our teeth. The shepherds were declared that in 2 Ezra 102, experience only can tell the joy in one's heart at a time when rescued from everlasting ruin and granted everlasting life without tasting death. Once our names will be retained in the Lamb's Book of Life after that final day of atonement, then our salvation is guaranteed. Brothers and sisters, we will no longer to taste death. It says, granted everlasting life without tasting death, merged into eternity's ceaseless ages, a life that measures with the life of God. But opposite also to those who will be involved in everlasting ruin. It says in 1 Ezra 185, the disappointment to such a one would be greater than we can't realize. The disappointment to such a one would be greater than we can realize. Experience only can tell the sorrow and grief at such a time. Maybe at this present time, we might be among that multitudes that derided, laughed, and ridiculed Noah. But the time will come when everything ceased to be funny. According to 1 TG 50, page 15. It says, life is but what we make it. 1 TG 50, page 15. Noah was commanded to build an ark and to tell the world that a flood was to cover the earth, that only those who would get into the ark would escape alive. 120 years later, the animals were strangely seen to march to and through into the ark. Noah and his family also went in, while the rest of the world laughed and ridiculed. But when the rain began to pour, the situation ceased to be funny. Those outside the ark cried, mourned, plead, but all perished as fools only because they had failed to give heed to present truth, had failed to feed on meat in due season. What folly, what disaster. The voice of inspiration says, reminding us, saying in 1 TG number 12, page 27, you remember that while Noah was preaching that a destruction would come from the Almighty, he was also preparing a place of refuge, building the ark. Those who doubted Noah's announcement of the flood and who scoffed at the idea that they should enter the ark for safety at a time when there was not even the slightest sign of threatening rain. There was not even the slightest sign of threatening rain. Were doubters no longer when the elements of nature were unleashed. Then they madly rushed to the ark. But to their dismay and utter disappointment, they found the door tightly closed against them. Thus all, both good and bad, who choose to remain outside the ark, perish. The antediluvian's experience should serve as a reminder to us that we be not presumptuous as were they. We should instead take to heart the clear warning that is pertinent to this hour. For we are told that as it was in the days of the flood, so shall it be at the time of the Lord's coming. But in the great controversy, it is pointing to the time when the irrevocable decision will be pronounced in the heavenly sanctuary. It says here, in the great controversy, page 490. This is the statement that I would like to read. The righteous and the wicked will still be living upon the earth in their mortal state. Men will be planting and building, eating and drinking, all unconscious that the final irrevocable decision has been pronounced in the sanctuary above. Before the flood, after Noah entered the ark, God shut him in and shut the ungodly out. But for 7 days, the people, knowing not that their doom was fixed, continued their careless, pleasure-loving life, and mocked the warnings of impending judgment. So says the Savior, shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Matthew 24, verse 39. Silently, and notice as the midnight thief, will come the decisive hour which marks the fixing of every man's destiny, final withdrawal of mercy offered to guilty men. The great controversy, 490 and 491. And that is pointing to the last and the final day of atonement. According to track number 15, on page 28, it says, in the typical atonement, everyone's destiny among the professed people of God was forever fixed. Those who complied with the demands of the law were left to live, and those who did not were cut off from among the people. Thus, it must also be in the antitypical atonement. The voice of inspiration says, the destiny of the professed people of God was forever fixed. And remember, brothers and sisters, the judgment begin at the house of God. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. The very statement on the great controversy, 485, it says here, the great controversy, saying that the judgment of the wicked world will take place at the latter period. But the judgment must begin at the house of God. The great controversy, page 480. The judgment of the wicked is a distinct and separate work and takes place at a latter period. Judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel? That gospel is pertaining to the present truth under the judgment that pertains to the living. And what shall the end of them, according to 2 SR page 101. It says, Peter saw a time when God will judge the church. 2 Azar, page 101. Peter saw a time when God will judge the church. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? 1 Peter 4:17. What would be the end of him who enters not the ark of safety, but dares bar the way of others? The blood of the souls will be found upon their garments. They will be held responsible. That reading in 2 Azar 101, the quotation is Isaiah 63. And here in answerer number 4, concerning Isaiah 63, answerer number 4, page 23, it says that whoever continues to hold his people in bondage and in ignorance of his truth, will he tread in his anger and trample them in his fury and sprinkle their blood upon his garments, thereby staining all his raiment and thus setting his people free. Answer number 4, page 23. That whoever continues to hold his people in bondage and ignorance. And that is pointing to those who are in responsible position, because the leadership always stand against present truth. And in 1 TG number 18, page 17, it says, what a fearful responsibility rests upon those who carelessly handle the word of God, who pose as sole guardians over the people, but who in reality are guarding that no soul escape landing in hell. Both they and their abominations will fall in the ditch. Indeed, if any reform is needed in Christendom, it is certainly needed worse in this one line. 1 TG, number 18, page 17. Now, brothers and sisters, we already read several times that the great and dreadful day of the Lord is divided into different phases. If it is pertained to the heavenly sanctuary, that is pointing to the final day of atonement, by which at that time, we will be either among those names left written in the Lamb's Book of Life, or either we will be among those names that will be blotted out. And it is called great and dreadful day. Great to those people whose names had been left written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the shepherds called it, what a blessed assurance. What is that blessed assurance? The blessed assurance is that the promise given in Daniel 12 verse 1, that all the names left written in the Lamb's Book of Life, God will deliver them. And what a blessed assurance, according to the voice of inspiration. White House Recruiter, page 11. What is of first and supreme importance to each, however, is to know for a surety that his name is written in the book. To have this most blessed assurance, one must first know what will keep one's name out of the book and what will put it in. So what a blessed assurance, brothers and sisters. The only book that counts, the voice of inspiration, is emphasizing, brothers and sisters, according to the shepherd's rod, that is the only book by which it really counts, brothers and sisters. That according to the shepherd's rod, it doesn't matter if our names in this world will be cast out as evil, or our names will be blotted out in the church book. The most important part, brethren, is to have our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that is the only book that counts and grant us for eternity. Now let me read to you the statement in Timely Greetings. I love so much all these passages, brethren. And here in 1 TG, number 37, page 19, shall we not be thankful to know that everyone whose name is found in the book shall be delivered? That is the promise. In track number 1, page 46, it says, that indeed your accepting the truth and obeying it is the only thing that will forever ensure your membership with the redeemed in the church eternal, and that the only book that is ultimately worthwhile having your name in is the Lamb's Book of Life. Tract number 1, pages 45 and 46. That indeed, you're accepting the present truth, you're accepting the gospel, and obeying, it is the only thing that will forever ensure your membership with the redeemed in the church eternal. And that the only book that is ultimately worthwhile having your name in is the Lamb's Book of Life. So what a wonderful statement, right? And also the statement in 1TG, number 28, page 12. Indeed, the important thing is not how good or how bad we are or have been, but how susceptible and submissive we are to present truth as it unfolds. The real burden of our prayer should be that we catch a vision of the truth that makes us free, if accepted as the scroll and rules. If accepted. 1TG 31, page 13, it says, now while the eternal records are being made, will you not cause your name to be written among the great heroes of God? How can you afford to eternally lose out at such a late hour? What a wonderful statement, brethren. And also the statement, let me read to you. In 1TG number 12, page 26. So here, the Shepherd's Rod is emphasizing 1TG 31, page 8. There is no Bible truth plainer than this. And there is no truth as important at this time as is this truth. These are the very reasons that it either saves or destroys. To accept it is to have all your sins blotted out. To reject it is to sin against the Holy Ghost. So what truth that if you reject, you commit the unpardonable sin? That is the present truth. 2SR 198. Thus, the rejection of light and truth, which is the present truth, is the sin against the Holy Ghost. 2SR page 198. So it is high time now, brethren, to examine closely if the church we belong, the present truth, is within our borders, because that is represented by the blood on the doorpost. That if there is no blood on the doorpost, there is no safety at all. The destroying angel will enter therein. Brethren, the voice of inspiration says, here in 2SR page 169, it says, again, we note at the time of the Passover in Egypt, the blood on the doorpost was a type of the marking or sealing. Now, let us study closely the subject, marking or sealing. Then it says in the next paragraph, in that night, wherever the blood appeared on the doorpost, the firstborn, whether male or female, perished not. So whether male or female, if you are within that house by which there is a blood on the doorpost, all of them were saved. Nobody perished. Contrariwise, to all the houses without the blood on the doorpost, lying dead bodies. And what is the blood on the doorpost? That is represented by the present truth. And that admonition in tract number 14 on page 22, saying here in prophetic utterance, is not only a promise to purify the church when modern Assyria is being crushed, but also a suggestive statement as to what constitutes meat in due season for men today, and as to what movement they are to enlist in if they would make sure of salvation. You want to make sure of your salvation? Ascertain clearly what movement you are to enlist in. And the only movement that you need to enlist in must be the movement where the present truth at this present time had been bestowed by God. That is the only movement. Because God's church is well marked in every generation by obedience to present truth. 2SR page 125. God has never had more than one movement in existence at a time, and it could not be otherwise now, for Christ cannot be divided. God's church is well marked in every generation by obedience to present truth. So the divine earmark placed by God so that His people can easily recognize that that is the church recognized by God as His. It is true obedience to present truth. In 11 symbolic code, number 3, page 5, present truth comes only from God. That is very plain. Therefore, it is illogical that God will entrust His present truth to a movement by which He does not recognize as His movement. Logically, therefore, unto whom the present truth was bestowed by God, for sure, that is His movement. And that is why, in track number 14, page 38, it says, and to know their church aright through timely truth is what brings life eternal. How do you recognize the right church? According to the reading, only through timely truth. Brothers and sisters, ponder deeply the statement in answerer number 1, that B.T. Hotep made it so plain that from 1890 to 1930, for 40 years, there is no timely truth revealed in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But some brethren objected because according to them, from 1890, Sister White continually published many books. The prophet herself published many books in that period of time. But B.T. Hotep says, saying, though many of Sister White's manuscripts were published during the period of time stated above, yet a careful check will reveal that if any new revelation of timely Bible truth met in due season was published therein, it was revealed to her before 1890. Therefore, that example, that illustration, it doesn't mean because you are publishing many books, the present truth, the timely truth is within our borders. Look at the prophet herself. She publishes many books from 1890 up to 1915. But the word of God, very plain, there was no timely truth at that time. Now, if we, the Bedian, is only publishing the books of B.T. Hotep, the Shepherd's Rod publications, brothers and sisters, it doesn't mean that we have the timely truth. And the Shepherd's Rod declared clearly in 2SR page 93, it says, 2SR page 93, does not one of these churches have had additional light on the scriptures other than that which was imparted to them by the founders of each movement? I would like to read again. 2SR page 93, does not one of these churches have had additional light on the scriptures other than that which was imparted to them by the founders of its movement? Are the messages that we have today are only the messages that was imparted to us by B.T. Hotep? Then we have no additional light. Additional light must be a message by which it was not understood by B.T. Hotep. And if you fully believe that B.T. Hotep could never be a part of the 144,000 living saints, then you need to understand that this reading in 2SR 172 saying, the song was sung in heaven by heavenly beings before the throne and before the beast and the elders. Therefore, it is evident that the judgment was in progress. Note that the 144,000 did not sing, but they only could learn the song as it was sung in heaven. That is, they alone understood the heavenly truth in that particular time and their position in connection with the message they must bear. Undoubtedly, the heavenly truth mentioned here is the present truth, by which such present truth is intended only to the 144,000 living saints, and that is the present truth under the seventh seal. Because according to 2SR 202, the seventh seal being the last must concern the living. 1SR 28, it says, according to the scriptures, we must conclude that the saints of God in all generations, in all ages, are sealed with present truth. And whatever the present truth is, that is the seal. 2SR 215, as the six seals are sealing period, therefore the seventh seal must be also a sealing period. Otherwise, it cannot be called the seventh seal. Therefore, there must be a specific present truth under the seventh seal, by which such present truth is intended to the saints that will no longer to taste death. And the statement here in 2 SR 172, the particular time mentioned is none other than the judgment for the living. So here the voice of inspiration says, let us read in one symbolic code, number 15, page 8. It will be noted that the shepherd's rod is stating this of the 144,000 in comparison with the dead and not with the great multitude. One symbolic code, number 15, page 8. It says the comparison is with the dead and Bethlehem is among with the dead. Therefore, there must be a wide difference between those who died and the living saints that will no longer to taste death, because they have that present truth by which that present truth never been understood by any of them who died. And Bethlehem was among them. Brethren, I would like to repeat again that the prophets of God are divided into two divisions. The first division, they are the prophets that had been raised by God predicting the event, but they died before the event was materialized. But at the time when the predicted event will be carried out, the predicted event will be fulfilled, then God would raise up a prophet to inform all the people that those predicted events that had been predicted by the prophets will be at last be now be fulfilled. For example, the first advent of Jesus Christ, hundreds of prophets prophesied the coming of the Messiah. But when the actual event finally came, God raised up John the Baptist to inform the people that such predicted event at last came and being fulfilled. So that is, for example, Bethlehem. All of his predictions, brothers and sisters, never been materialized in his lifetime. He died without witnessing the events that he has predicted. And that statement in manuscript release, book 1417, that each of ancient prophets spoke less in their time, and their prophesying is in force unto us, by which those predictions will at last be now at fulfillment. Now, brethren, that verse in the Bible, Amos 3, verse 7, that the Lord will do nothing except he revealed his secret unto his servants, the prophets. As I've said, divided into two divisions. First, God raised up a prophet predicting the event. But when the event will at last be fulfilled, then God raised up the prophet to announce that predicted event. And we are now on that very fulfillment of the prophecy. And here, brothers and sisters, the statement in volume 6, page 19, saying, the Lord God of heaven will not send upon the world his judgments for disobedience and transgression until he has sent his watchmen to give the warning. He will not close up the period of provision until the messages shall be more distinctly proclaimed. Volume 6, page 19. That is the character of God. There was no such occurrence ever recorded in the history, in the past, that God punished that nation, that God destroyed without first sending a warning. Yes, you might say, concerning the slaughtering, it was already predicted by Bethlehem. How about Sister White? There are many statements in the writings of Sister White concerning slaughtering. Manuscript release, book 1, page 260. But brethren, according to God's uniform dealing, that there must be a prophet, there must be a messenger at the time when that predicted event will be finally be materialized, then in order for the people to live without an excuse, God need to raise a prophet to proclaim the message, to warn the people, so that they will either choose to be among the living saints or choose to be among the living wicked. Everybody is given the chance. Life is but what we make it. Brothers and sisters, this statement in tract number 1, page 29 and page 30, it says, as the words which Ezekiel was to speak to his people were found in the book which he ate, the book can be none other than the Bible, from which comes the message culminating in joy, mourning, and woe. I think only to the righteous by which the message will culminate in joy, but to the wicked, mourning and woe. And lo, a roll of a book was therein, and he spread it before me. And it was written within and without, and there was written therein lamentations and mourning and woe. Ezekiel 2 verse 9 and 10. Thy right in visaging the slaughter in Ezekiel 9. You see, brothers and sisters, the message is projecting, portraying the slaughter in Ezekiel chapter 9. And the woes pronounced in the master's parables, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then said the king to the servants, bind him hand and foot, and take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Matthew 24 verse 50-51 and Matthew 22 verse 13. What is the main subject? The slaughtering in Ezekiel chapter 9. Brothers and sisters, who are they that is not aware of the slaughtering in Ezekiel 9? The evil servant. Brothers and sisters, for sure, the faithful and wise servant, he is aware of that day. The voice of inspiration says, in 11 symbolic code, number 12, on page 7, it says, if no one is to know the day and hour until the Lord comes, then how could this servant be aware of the day and the hour? Do you see that one statement seems to contradict the other? No one knows the hour, the day. Therefore, God's people must be ready for the event to occur at almost any time. And if this servant does not faithfully perform his duties, then when the Lord is about to come, that servant will not be aware of it. Is that not how you understand these two statements? Yes. Up to a certain time, God's people do not know the day and the hour. But if they continue to receive meat in due season, as they will come, when this servant is going to be made aware of that hour, of that day. If we will continue to receive meat in due season, meaning the progressive revelation of truth, brothers and sisters, the time will come. Of course, because that is the character of God. Would you think God will destroy such people by such slaying without giving the message to warn the people to escape the day of vengeance? That is not the character of God. And it is illogical, and there is no justice at all, brothers and sisters. But thank God, God is a merciful God. He will inform first His people, because in reality, God's desire is to save rather than to destroy. Destruction with a merciful God is a strange word, a strange act, meaning He has no desire to destroy. But sometimes, we as human beings are the very ones who force God to destroy us because of our disobedience. Now, I would like to read again that statement in White House Recruiter on page 24, saying, with these solemn words, the Lord warns that the slaughter, the antitypical Passover, is to take place among those who are of the household of God, the church. For the escaped ones are sent to the Gentiles who as yet have not heard of God's fame and His glory. Obviously, the angels who execute this slaughter are to take away from the church the unrighteous, those who are figuratively depicted in one instance as bad fish and in another instance as guests not having the wedding garment. It says the Lord warns that the slaughter, what is the slaughter? That is during the antitypical Passover. Now, brethren, to repeat again, here in Timely Greetings 2TG41, you can read the entire booklet, 2TG41. It was entitled here in page 3, Current Events, the Palestine Situation, and How Close the Separation. Now, lastly, it says, I have been asked to give a study on current events on the Palestine situation and on the separation caused by the slaughter that is forecast in Ezekiel's vision. I wish that I could tell you all you want to know, but I cannot say how soon the separation, the purification of the church will take place. God alone knows the time. All I know is that it cannot take place before we prepare the way, before our God-given work in connection with Ezekiel 9 is done. Then it will come to pass that the Lord will suddenly come to His temple, the church, and purify the sons of Levi, the ministry. But those who receive not the mark will fall under the slaughter weapons of the angels, as did the unfaithful firstborn in the night of the Passover in the land of Egypt. This reading, brethren, concretely builds the absolute fact that B.T. Hunter is a prophet that God hath raised before the event will be fulfilled. And it is illogical for the Almighty God to reveal to B.T. Hunter when would be the days of slaughter, by which in reality, B.T. Hunter, the messenger, as well as the people by which he was proclaiming the message, all of them will be laid down to sleep before the event will take place, and such information and revelation will be out of value. But it is even more illogical to the very people by which they will be the one to experience such tremendous events, and God will not inform them. Brothers and sisters, and there will be no justice at all with such secrecy. And the shepherd's rod itself declared here in 2 TJ 41 page 3, I am, however, certain that God will not keep us ignorant of the things we ought to know. If it becomes necessary for us to know ahead of time the day and hour of the purification of the church, the antitypical Passover, we will be told. Yes, we will be told. And would you think such information will be given at the time when everything is too late? That is not how God works. The same with the statement in 1SR Packet Edition, page 9 and 10. Any thinker knows that to have made known the truth of it before time, for example, the devil's slaughter, if God would have made known to B.T. Hunter, it says, would have left it as vain, valueless, and ineffective. As would making known the truth about the image of the beast years before or a minute after it does its deceptive work, but at the striking of the foreordained hour, the time inspiration unlocks the mystery, all can behold the truth and profit by it. Happily, we can then intelligently strive to be among this guileless company and can be sealed with them if we sincerely and steadfastly follow on to know the truth on time. 1SR Packet Edition, page 9 and page 10. And the same with the statement in tract number 2, page 12. It says, never has this symbolical prophecy been understood by any people, and never could it have been fulfilled and not been revealed. For then would its truth have been unavailable to the people in the past, and but half efficacious to us now. Necessarily then, its fulfillment is yet future, sometime in the latter part of the Christian era. So that is the character of God. God would not waste the time of His servants to write those messages, more particularly pertaining to the future events, brethren. And then it will be fulfilled at the time by which the people by which the message is particularly intended to them, then the prophecy had been fulfilled and they themselves know nothing about it. Very illogical. And the question is, for what purpose they had been written? In answerer number 2, page 75, it says, those prophecies or these prophecies must therefore be revealed in order to strengthen the church in her final warfare. Otherwise, for what purpose were they written? For what purpose were they written? Romans 15 verse 4. For whatsoever written. For whatsoever, brothers and sisters, the things that had been written. It is for our learning. For our comfort. By which through those written words, inspired records, we could ascertain clearly what is in the past, what is in the present, and what is in the future. And at this present time, the judgment for the living is going forward in progress. brothers and sisters. It says here in 1 TG number 12, page 26, ever remember that the books are opened and examined during the judgment day, that our names be found in that book should now be the most absorbing concern of each of us. That is the most absorbing concern of each of us. To make sure that on that Day of Atonement, this coming Day of Atonement, October 10, 2022, by which in Gregorian calendar, that would be on March 27, 2021. Make it sure that on that 24 hours, we could be able to survive, that our names be left written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Because after that event, brothers and sisters, the irrevocable decision will be pronounced. Nobody could alter the situation. Our destiny is forever fixed. And it was illustrated here. It says, one symbolic code, number 6, page 9. One symbolic code, number 6, page 9, says, therefore, after the first and second angels' messages were presented to the people at that time, their provision clothes and their destinies were unalterably fixed, either for eternal life or eternal death, as was the case with Saul, king of Israel. It is pertaining, brethren, to the judgment, the proclamation of the first and second angels' messages in the judgment that pertains to the living. What is the first angel's message? It is to inform the people of God that the judgment for the living is in session. And what is the message of the second angel? Why is it that the message of second angel is attached? The message of the second angel is to inform all the people that such message of the first angel cannot be originated in the United States of America. There are two Babylons, the type. Remember, it says, the picture tells the story and symbols do not lie, right? That is the statement given by the voice of inspiration in 1SR. Picture tells the story, symbols do not lie. 1SR 124. And according to the picture, which is the type, it says, 1SR 226, the types themselves are not the true object, no more than a photograph is, but it is a representation which pictures an unmistakable evidence the object in view. What kind of evidence? Unmistakable. And according to the voice of inspiration, in 2SR page 245, it says, thus the second angel's message of Revelation 14 verse 8 was proclaimed immediately after the disappointment, saying, Babylon is fallen, is fallen. That is, the world in 1844 fell in the same manner as the one before the flood. What is the Babylon before the flood? That is pertaining to the churches, because there was no state, there was no nation, there was no imperialism before the flood. State and nations and imperialism began after the flood. But the voice of inspiration says, the present world is called Babylon because the kingdom of Babylon is the immediate one after the flood. Thus Babylon become the mother of the nations. So Revelation 14:8 is divided into two phases. The first phase, it is the antitypical Babylon before the flood, the antediluvian world, by which that message is directed to all the churches prior to 1844. The churches that had been raised by God during the Dark Ages, by which the message, according to 2SR 288 and also 2SR page 97, is to inform them that God will no longer let any light to originate from those churches from 1844 onwards. But that is not the perfect fulfillment of the prophecy of Revelation 14 verse 8. And what is the Babylon after the flood? Nations. And modern Babylon is the two-horned beast domain. Two symbolic code, number 1, page 8. And that is the fulfillment of 2 TG 22, page 22. Brothers and sisters, God's spirit have been quieted in the north country. What is the north country? Babylon. But what Babylon? The modern Babylon. The modern Babylon after the flood. And that is the United States of America. As stated in 2 symbolic code, number 1, page 8. It says here, as the fulfillment of this prophecy is yet future, we cannot now tell who will then be the head king of the north of this prophetic nation, modern Babylon, that is symbolized by the two-horned beast. There is no other nation symbolized by the two-horned beast except the United States of America. Brothers and sisters, the north country, Babylon, modern Babylon, United States of America. And the voice of inspiration says, God's spirit have been quieted in the north country. 2TG number 22, page 22. And 100%, it really points out to the United States of America, because the fourth chariot, according to track number 2, page 34, point out to the Laodicean church. But the causes of God's spirit that had been silenced in the north country, it says, especially the one of the fourth chariot, and the phrase one of indicates more than one. So the statement one of the fourth chariot, one of the Laodiceans, because Laodiceans is divided into two, typical and antitypical. What does it mean by Laodicea? People declaring judgment. The typical Laodicean, the people declaring the judgment that pertains to the dead, and the antitypical Laodicea is the people declaring the judgment that pertains to the living. But in other study, the typical Laodiceans, track number 8, page 47 and 48, they are represented by antitypical soul, but the people declaring the judgment of the living, that is the antitypical Laodicea, and they were the seven antitypical brothers of David. And that is very plain. Number 7 indicates completeness. It is God who declared it. It says, which caused the spirit of truth to turn away and to bring truth no more through them. No more. The word no more indicates that there was a period of time by which the truth originated in the United States of America. Look at brothers and sisters, William Miller, Ellen G. White, Alonzo Jones, Wagoner, B.T. Hotep. Yes, that is the period of time by which the truth was channeled by God into that nation, United States of America. But the time came, God declared, no more. Do not expect any truth. No more truth to originate in the United States of America. And it says to be silent there. God's spirit has been silent there. And that, therefore, there is not to be expected any truth through them. Why expect something? Because God says, do not expect any truth that will originate in the United States of America. And that is the very message in 1 Symbolic Code, number 6, page 9. After this message, the first and the second angel's messages were proclaimed on that Day of Atonement, March 27, 2021. Brothers and sisters, the first and second angel's message is finished. Finished to what? To the church. Brothers and sisters, it is coupled together. Because unless you will understand the second angel's message, you will be, brothers and sisters, at a loss to find the truth. Because you will be expecting messages from the United States of America. That's what all the people in the world expecting. They were looking to the United States of America. While God himself declared, do not expect any truth through them. What is the pronoun them? All of them within the North Country. Because my spirit is no longer speaking in the North Country. And the mere fact that not even one among the media that have knowledge concerning this momentous event, that this is the final Day of Atonement, the coming Day of Atonement, is the strongest proof that cannot be denied. They were in total darkness, brothers and sisters. And that is the fulfillment of the vision recorded in the book of Daniel, that the sanctuary had been trodden underfoot. And it says here in track number 4, on page 26, note that the truth and the place, what not the sanctuary itself, were cast down. That is, both Christ's truth and his place in the earthly sanctuary were set aside so that the knowledge as to his mediatorial work became obscured. What do you mean by obscured? Darkened. Brethren, if you will study closely the subject concerning the exceeding great horn, the shepherds had declared clearly that it is the brass kingdom that shall be rule over all the earth. 2SR page 139, it says, the horn bears rule over all the earth. It says here, 2SR 139, these are facts which cannot be denied. However, there is another proof that bears evidence of the same. Say the prophet, after thee, king of Babylon, shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall be ruled over all the earth. Daniel 2 verse 39. The brass kingdom is accepted to represent Grecia, but the fact is that Grecia never did be ruled over all the earth. The more distant point of the compass reached by Alexander the Great, was a portion of India. Neither did Imperial Rome be ruled over all the earth. What then? Is Daniel wrong in the interpretation of the dream? If there is any error, Daniel cannot be at fault. The responsibility would naturally fall on God, who was the overseer of all the writings and the interpretation of the scriptures. If Daniel had made a mistake, it was God's duty to have him correct it. But as God is perfect in all his work, he cannot allow error in his holy word. Daniel is correct in his interpretation, and the brass kingdom must be ruled over all the earth, for all else may fail, but God's word shall stand forever. So what does it mean that the brass kingdom shall be ruled over all the earth? You need to study closely the exceeding great horn. It simply means that the exceeding great horn were divided into three stages, three phases: imperial, papal, and Protestant period, according to tract number 3, page 39. So what does it mean by the brass kingdom? The same with Zechariah chapter 6, that the brass is pointing to numerical number 3, tract number 2, page 13, indicating that it was predicted beforehand that the exceeding great horn shall be ruled all over the earth, brothers and sisters, in the third period, not in the first period, Imperial Rome, not in the second period, Papal Rome, but only in the third period. What does it mean that the brass kingdom or the exceeding great horn in the third period shall be ruled all over the earth? Brothers and sisters, the focal point is God's people, the church. Imperial Rome is a universal kingdom. So the focal point of the subject is the church. That although the Imperial Rome is very powerful in that period of time, but it cannot be the fulfillment of that vision that the exceeding great horn be ruled all over the earth, because at that time there is still God's people within his domain. That the exceeding great horn had not been able to darken their understanding concerning the sanctuary doctrine, because the focal point is the daily and the sanctuary. Daniel chapter 8. And that is the apostolic church. The exceeding great horn failed to darken the understanding of the apostolic church. How about in the second period, by which the dominion of the papacy is the continent of Europe? The voice of inspiration says that during the dark ages, there is still God's people. It says here in 2 SR 142, it says, so while the truth was cast down by the church leadership in that period and the abomination set up, God had some in obscurity who keep his Sabbath and had knowledge of the sanctuary truth through the entire 1260 years of wilderness journey. 2 SR 142. If the exceeding great horn had been able to rule all over the earth in the first period, Imperial Rome, the Bible would have said it. It must be the iron, brothers and sisters. But the mere fact, the Bible never say. Rather, it is the brass to indicate the third period of the exceeding great horn, by which the third period represents the Protestant period, brothers and sisters. Therefore, to say that there is a group in the United States of America that are still standing at this present time, by which they have knowledge concerning the daily and the sanctuary, or the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary, then we are saying that God had mistaken to declare that in the third period, the exceeding great horn had been trodden underfoot, not only the sanctuary itself, but as well as the place itself. That Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary being obscured in the understanding of God's people. The Bible cannot be mistaken. The Bible must stand. Do not fool yourself, brethren. The entire two-horned beast domain, the United States of America, had been completely defeated by the devil. If there is still a divinely called movement in the United States of America, there will be no mark of the beast system. Therefore, the revelation in Revelation 13, by which the very place by which the mark of the beast system will originate in the United States of America, is the strongest proof that the divinely called movement, the final, the 11th hour movement, does not originate in the United States of America. That is the absolute fact, brethren. I am not saying that the people in the United States of America are wicked. No, that is not the message. Brother Hotep says, the only message that we proclaim, that God's people are in darkness. And they needed the light of the present truth. Brothers and sisters, but if you will follow the attitude of the Jewish people by which they were so proud, even though they were in total darkness, then according to the Shepherd's Rod, here in, I would like to read in Anzurer, this is the very message. It says, Anzurer number 1, page 16, be not like the Jew, be not like the Jew, but open your heart, cast out its pride, its prejudice, and its self-conceit. Let this not deprive you of eternal life at such a late hour as this. If you repeat the mistake of the Jews, your shame and your loss will be as much greater than theirs, as are your light and your opportunities and privileges, yea, beyond comparison. So do not fail. We plead with you to end your long Laodicean sickness and poverty, and no longer imagine that you are rich in grace with goods. We love you, brethren, and hoping that God would help us to awaken our senses that the remaining days for this investigative judgment for the living is about finished. And next time we will proceed to the subject, the 12 figurative months, because this coming September 4, 2020, there is a very important event that will take place in the heavenly sanctuary. This coming September 4, 2020. And before that event will take place, we will give you all the necessary information. Yes, our subject is concerning the day of slaughter. But the voice of inspiration says, but how can one escape the day of slaughter? It says here in 1SR Packet Edition, page 9, and how can one escape the slaughter unless one knows what the ceiling is, what the marking is, when it is, and where it is to be. That statement, where it is to be, I think the only the portion by which almost all the Bijan are total in ignorance concerning the sealing and the marking that takes place in the heavenly sanctuary. Where it is to be, the very first one that we need to know is the sealing and the marking that takes place in the heavenly sanctuary. So it is useless to know the day of slaughter, that the only way that we could escape that tremendous event, brothers and sisters, is to know completely the sealing and the marking. First, the sealing and the marking that takes place in the heavenly sanctuary, and when it is to be started and when it is to be finished. May the good Lord bless you and have a beautiful, wonderful evening. Thank you very much for listening and viewing this program. May the good Lord bless you and have a beautiful, wonderful evening.